Good morning. Welcome to this breakout session. Woo! That was a wake up. My name is Melissa Keysweater. I actually will introduce myself the way that I typically do. Ani Buju, Melissa Keysweater, Indigenous, Petoskey, Michigan, and Donjiba. I'm offering myself greetings and hello and my name in Anishinaabe Moen, which is the language of the original peoples of this area. I am the tribal liaison for the Michigan Department of Civil Rights and work in the DEI unit. I am very honored to be here with you all moderating this session, which is education and health. It is our first breakout session of the morning. And I am, again, very thankful and grateful to have our panelists, who I will spend a little bit of time introducing and reading their bios. So please, make yourselves comfortable. There is a water station in the back of the room. As you need to move around and get up, feel free. We have about an hour and 15 minutes together, and we will be having some time for Q&A. Again, this breakout session is education and health, and I am going to begin with introducing our esteemed panelists. To my farthest left, Rané Garcia. Rané Garcia is the Director of Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion for the Michigan Department of Education. She is honored, and we are thankful for her to be in the position and supporting districts, ISDs, and professional organizations as they work towards access, fairness, and belonging for all of Michigan students. Miigwech, and thank you, Rané Garcia, for being with us today. And in the middle, we have Dr. Alena Zachery-Ross. Dr. Zachery-Ross is the superintendent of Ypsilanti Community Schools. She is a visionary leader who leads by example. As the superintendent of YCS, Dr. Zachery-Ross always champions the education of all students with conviction, compassion, and determination. Her expertise as a transformational leader has led to the successful implementation of the district's My Excel Blueprint for Rapid Turnaround, which is responsible for disrupting the educational infrastructure to ensure academic achievement for all students at YCS. Student achievement is at the core of her work, and she leads by being visible and making no excuses about the importance of doing the work right and doing right work. And directly to my left, Dr. Rema Reynolds Vassar. Dr. Reynolds Vassar teaches educational leadership to aspiring K-12 teachers, educators, students, parents, and community activists. Dr. Rema's research is centered in schools serving culturally diverse students and families. She's committed to every student learning. Dr. Rema works as a consultant, equipping educators with reflexive practices that allow them to take deliberate action and increase equity and access for all students. With a focus on developing transformative leaders committed to radical hope and love, she has taught and presented at professional conferences throughout the United States and in over 20 countries. Dr. Rema believes in the power of education to change the world. Consistently building within communities, Dr. Rema brings authenticity to every space and is known for her love for people, her desire to actualize the collective power of people. Knowledge is power, power is freedom. Dr. Rema wants us all to be free. Again, Miigwech, thank you to our panelists, and we will begin with our opening question for all of the panelists. If you could, please share with the audience why you so graciously accepted to be a part of the panel, and what about your work connects to this topic, and what about this topic connects to your work? And feel free, anyone who'd like to start.
Hold, yeah. Watch us to be a part of this panel because education and health just go hand in hand. Post-pandemic, truly the impact, especially in 4197. In Washtenaw County, YCS was truly impacted. We don't understand even completely right now how education and health coupled by the impact of the pandemic really has impacted our students. Currently, our students are seeing mental health professionals. Their families are still seeing mental health professionals. Our ROS clinic, those are the clinics that we have in our middle school and high schools in our buildings. They are used daily by our students, by their families. And so we're seeing the increase of mental health professionals, the care professionals in our buildings, by our students, by their families every single day. There's a wait list of seeing care professionals. We're trying to ensure that they are able to see care professionals. And so every single day, our teachers, our counselors are helping families to match the students with outside professionals. And so this is a subject that I'm dearly interested in. I profoundly would like even the public to know that we have to all work together to ensure that the public know that education and health is a priority for everyone. And so this panel is important for me.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Good. It's morning. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming to this panel. Thank you for having me. I am on the panel because I was voluntold by Rene Garcia. Really don't have a choice. If she says, can you come? I say, yes. Tell me where to be. And I do want to note that Rene, I think it was 3 weeks ago, you defended your prospectus. So she's almost ready to be Dr. Garcia. So I wanted to make sure I raised that. So I think I was voluntold because my work in education really thinks about intersectionality and the ways that education is at the epicenter of all things in society. Everything we do or don't do in schools directly impacts what happens in our society. We reproduce society through our schools. And so if we're thinking about any inequity or any justice, we need to look at schools first. And when I think about health. You need some water?
Thank you. I'm going to get some. Okay. I'll get you all some.
Okay. When I think about health and my work in Detroit, the COVID-19 to me was not the reason for health disparity. It just highlighted already what was there, right? That we already have these disparities in how we are fed, right? Food deserts, how the stress of allostatic load of racism and oppression, how that indirectly affects how then we're treated for COVID, access to healthcare and prenatal care, things like this. All of these are intersecting. So if we're thinking about changing our health system, changing our food system, changing our prenatal systems, we're thinking about these things, we need to think about what we can do in schools. How are we preparing people to think about equity and justice as they go into their medical programs? How are we even preparing them to get to medical school? And really, we're thinking about minoritized people because Detroit inequitably hit with COVID. We saw more deaths. We saw more prolonged illness in Detroit because of all those other factors. So when students came to talk about COVID-19, they talked about how their parents were dying, their grandparents were dying, how they were working full-time jobs and going to school online, right? Their education was directly impacted by what happened with all those other health issues. So I don't see them as separate and apart. I see them as both necessary for justice work to be addressed equally. And the more we can get young people into STEM to be thinking about health disparities, then we know that health will change. we do know that minoritized doctors do different work in minoritized communities. So we need to make sure that we're priming the pipeline. So everything that I ever do, working with students, working with parents, working with leaders, and being on the MyStem, the governor's MyStem collective, to think about how we're doing STEM in Michigan, all of that really leads into why I think I was voluntold.
Thank you so much. Rene.
Good morning. We're going to get back to the voluntold in a minute, but first of all, I just want to express my appreciation for being here. I am here as part of the Department of Education and as an equity inclusion officer for the Department of Education. So I have the great honor to work with equity inclusion officers throughout all of the departments in the state of Michigan, and it is such a dynamic group. So when Alfredo Hernandez started working on planning this and asked if I would join the planning team and then said, hey, we want to do a breakout with education, and who do you know that could come sit with us and talk about education and health together, it was a clear choice to choose Dr. Rema. We've had the opportunity to work together now for, 4 years, I think. And then prior to that, I was an assistant superintendent for Alena in Muskegon Heights. So I'm really honored to be sitting here with these two women, these two educators, these two leaders in the field. As I think about my work, I was 31 years in local school districts, a teacher, a principal, assistant superintendent, and then a superintendent. And when I first started out, I was convinced that I could change the world from my classroom. And the further I got along, and the more inequities that I saw, the different places that I worked, the different systemic issues that I saw, it convinced me that we can't do it alone. Education is not in and of itself. And Dr. Rema listed a lot of the different pieces, right? The food deserts, the healthcare, housing, all of those pieces work together, affect health. And when health is affected, education is affected. So being able to sit here on this panel and share some ideas today that we're working on at the Department of Education, I'm really excited to do that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We're going to enter into a conversation that will have some tag-along questions, but I'm going to start with the question that recognizing that cultural competency is critical for students to feel welcome, to feel a sense of belonging, and to support their cultural identity. What is the impact on students? Here's the question. What is the impact on students who attend schools that are lacking culturally competent practices?
We just made a new rule. The last is first. Okay. So the impact, when I think about students not seeing themselves reflected in the curriculum, that's when they see themselves only reflected in negative stereotypes, it eats away, right? It is difficult for a student to see their heritage, to see the celebration of their culture, and to see their potential future selves. So I think from a couple different angles. Again, going back to serving a community that is 95% African American and thinking about the literature that we had in the classrooms, I wish we had done better. We are now continuing to do better, right? But if our students didn't see themselves represented in positive aspects, it makes it more difficult for them to imagine where they can go. So talking about literature, talking about history, Dr. Rema has a great personal experience on history that I'm hoping she's going to share, so I'll set her up with that.
Which one?
But I will say that growing up in rural Michigan, and I didn't know that I was rural, by the way, until I got to Paris and I met someone in Michigan, from Michigan, and there I was describing where I lived and where I grew up, and he was like, "Oh, so you're from a rural community?" I was like, "What? I'm cosmopolitan." But I detasseled corn in the summer, so I think that is pretty rural. But in that neighborhood, my brother and I were the two black children who went to that school, and we didn't see ourselves in the curriculum. The only time that I saw myself in a textbook was in a history book, and guess what I was doing in that book, right? It was one paragraph, right? And what do you think I looked like, right? And is that really the only contribution that black folks have given to this country? It's a huge contribution, free labor is. Also, though, there's been a lot more that has happened, right, since we've been free-ish. And so I not seeing myself represented does send a message of your worth, of your citizenship, of your contribution to the world, and of your potential. So I went into teaching, and I started teaching at Covert, Michigan, and then later in LA. I went into teaching so that no other student would feel that way. And I taught in California for 5 years, was a counselor and a principal. But I was very cognizant of the images that we show our children, because it does actually communicate when they're absent and when they're there. The other part, though, I think about when, and I hate the word competent, by the way, I just don't think you can be competent in culture. Like, culture continues to shift so rapidly that, you know, for example, I learned about emo students when I was a counselor in 2000. Do you know where emo students are now? Right, there's not any. So that competence that I had is no longer relevant. So I try to go with culturally relevant or culturally responsive, because I do think that you need to be responsive to the community that you serve. What will work in Muskegon Heights won't work in Pontiac, won't work in Saginaw, won't work in Detroit. So there is no way that you can just learn a culture and figure it out. But if you don't respond to a culture, then you do misread cues. For example, one student came to class with, in California, he was coming to class with these marks on his hands and his wrists. And they got sent to the office, right, for child abuse. It was an abuse and neglect case that they were sure, the teacher was sure of. Well, in his country, it was a healing technique. It was a practice for healing. And so if you don't know the culture you're serving, you can make catastrophic decisions on their behalf. So it's not just the literature and what we decide to teach, it's our practices, how we respect and treat folks based on who they show up as, right? And not thinking that our culture is the culture. Our culture is one culture, and we're literally here to serve the people who come into the space. So I think that if you don't have, I know what it did for me, thank God for my mother, by the way, who was hyper-vigilant in making sure that I saw all the images of blackness that was great and fantastic and innovative and creative and musical and beautiful and joyful, because if I had been reduced to that small paragraph with torn pants and dirty shirt and hoeing in the fields, I'm not sure where I would have been.
Thank you.
What happens to the students? And that's a good question. We see what happens. What happens is the students they lack the sense of belonging. And what happens is what we see on the news every single day. What happens is a room full of all of us who understand that there's a need to have all of us who are warriors, who feel this sense of urgency to do something. We all have this burning fire, this burning desire, because there's a need to fight for students, to fight for those who don't have a voice, to fight for those who aren't treated right, who wonder, do I belong? Those who say, do you see me? Do you hear me? Do you value me? Do you respect me? Because they know that they're not heard, that they're not seen, that they're not valued, that they're not respected. And so we don't have to say that to a student because they see it when they see a textbook that has animal characters instead of faces that don't look like them, that they go through books and they don't see themselves anywhere. They don't feel valued because of the culture, as Dr. Rema said, that does not understand their language, that does not understand they bring funds of knowledge, that they have to leave their culture and check their culture at the door. And so all of these practices that we seem to inherit when we go to our schools of education or when we have professional development that devalues the students or the students' families or cultures, that's what we're talking about when we say, ask this question about what happens when we don't understand when we don't have cultural proficient practices. And so when we think about Goldie Muhammad and when she talks about cultivating the genius, that's what she's talking about. And the five pursuits, that's what we're pursuing, is really thinking about the skills that we're talking about, those things. And so we're looking forward to bringing in the classroom the five pursuits, and we're thinking about how do we lift up that student and bring in the joy, bring in the skills, the criticality, all of those things, so that that student feels that sense of belonging.
Thank you so much. I'm going to continue along this topic. And for those districts who do not have or are lacking culturally relevant, culturally respectful practices, do you have some thoughts in terms of strategies or approaches to help these districts or schools address the need or fill that gap? And do you have any specific examples of ways in which you have been a part of that work?
Well, we talked about going back to last year, and so last year we did talk about adapting first that equity statement, and so thinking about where did the equity statement start with, and so thinking about what do you believe about the equity statement, and thinking about the team and what did the team say about the equity plan. And then bringing in those, bringing in other people. I talked about Goldie Muhammad, Yolanda Seeley Ruiz, Ken Williams, Zaretta Hammond, and others, to just kind of get it steeped, not just the sit and gets, but steeped within the culture of the district. Then having teachers work together on teachers' action research that really goes about the work, not just talking about it, but doing the action research in their classrooms to see how the practices work every single day in their classrooms, and then allowing students and their families to share their culture really seeing that their culture means something in their in the buildings, sharing their culture and allowing them to celebrate the culture within their buildings. Engaging students to self-explore and growing their own identities and their culture. Having some dual language immersion programs. A lot of the dual language immersion programs cost money, and you really see it in more affluent places, but making sure the dual immersion programs happen in places where there's no cost. And where that we can all have access, the newcomer systems, also in centers, also making sure that we start with self. Yolanda C. Ruiz talks about the archaeology of self. We are always growing. As Dr. Rema talked about, you know, this is a continuous growth thing. We don't ever become experts at it. And if you look at Yolanda, she always talks about sisters. She talks about this is about love and it's about internal growth, and we're never experts. And so if it's not about self-growth and development over and over and over, and just continuous growing, we'll never ever get it together. So it's constantly growing and learning over and over. If you think you become an expert in this area, then we've got it. We've got ourselves fooled. And so just continuing to grow and learn as much as we can.
So let me just remember your question. It was, what should schools do, or educators do? What strategies, I think you said.
Do you have any suggestions for strategies or approaches for those districts who are lacking or have a void or gap in culturally relevant practices?
Right, thank you. So I'm glad you said approaches, because I really don't like strategies or techniques or toolkits, because really that's that idea that you could just take something and put it someplace else, right? This technocratic way of changing schools, I think, is a problem. So the approach, I think, is first the courage, right? I don't think that this work is easy work. I don't think that it's popular work, and it always comes with the cost. All of you in this fight know that if you are advocating for the least of us, the most minoritized of us, the ones who are left out, you're going to take a hit. Personally, professionally, there's going to be a cost to that. That's what Busta Rhymes always says: for every choice, there's an invoice. If you choose freedom, it's going to cost you. So you need courage first. The second thing is what Dr. Alena was talking about, this idea that you have to learn about yourself first. I don't think that people who are in the majority think about culture because they don't have to. So you do have to think about ways to excavate how your culture is showing up and what actually is your culture, because if you don't, you should then, and I think this is the third approach, recognize that you'll continue to do harm, right? So go back to the second approach, which is to learn yourself. This learning yourself part, I think that's all the work that I do, right? I work with students on activism and changing their own schools. I do work with Michigan Department of Education with African American Student Initiative, working with educators across the state on issues of equity and justice. And I also have a conference, a free conference, this is like a shameless plug. It's a free online conference every single year in August, the second week of August, Centering Black Children in Education. Yolanda Celia Ruiz is gonna be our second keynote speaker this year. So you should look it up, Centering Black Children in Education. You should go ahead and register. It is free. But that kind of excavation work happens in every space that I'm in. In my classroom with my doctoral students at Wayne State, we start with leader know thyself, right? I'm teaching leadership classes there, so they're all going into a PhD or a master's in leadership. Leader know thyself first, because you and your dominant ethnocentrism are doing harm. And if you're not cognizant of who you are, you can't be cognizant of who you are to others. So the third thing is to accept your role in the harm, right? Like, I think we want to be better than, no, not us, we're the good ones. No, we're all terrible. Show up as your terrible self and accept that for that part so that you can then change it. If you don't know you're raggedy, that's a problem. That's a problem. It would take a couple of books to read, and I can give you a list to let you know how raggedy you are. But you, once you accept that, then you can do the hard work. And the hard work is reading. It's being in communication and community with people who are like-minded, surrounding yourself with justice-oriented folks, right? Like, not all people are in this work for real, for real. Let's just be clear. So you have to find out who your tribe is so you can get with them. Because there's going to be times when you're like, what the? I shouldn't have ever. Why did I? And you need somebody to say, nah, girl, homie, come on. We're about to do this, right? So you do have to surround yourself with other people. Figure out what they're reading. That's how you'll know your tribe. So read, number one, you gotta read yourself. And then you need to find other people who are reading the same things, going to the same conferences, this conference, going to the same, attending the same seminars, right? So that you can figure out who is in the work, because I think you said it, Renee, you can't do this work by yourself. All liberation work is collective work. And so if any of us want to be free, we all have to be free. We have to get free together. So you have to figure out how to do this work in collaboration with health, in collaboration with housing, with banking, right, with agriculture, right? Like all the intersectionalities, you have to figure out how you can make coalition with this. And I think that that's not just for educators. I think that's for everyone else, too. Educators, you have to rely on other people to change your schools, but everyone else who's not in education, you need, again, we change the world if we change schools. You need to partner with your local school district to make sure that you're breathing into them the life that they need in order to be free and to teach freedom in that space.
Thank you. Renee?
All right, strategies, approaches. I feel like I first gotta start with a full acknowledgement. My last name is Garcia. That is my married name. I am a white woman. Some of you may go, duh, of course you are. Some people don't know that. They see Garcia and they make an assumption. So I wanna be open about that. Growing up as a white woman, I didn't know I had culture until I sat in a class with Dr. Rema, and she's like, okay, you got to explore that, right? That's part of the problem, is not knowing that. So I appreciate all you said about just that self-digging in and working and acknowledging that and being willing to say it, being willing to get it wrong, and then being willing to listen. I think that's another piece that is so critical. What is it? Over 70% of educators are white women. 84, well over 70%. Thank you for that number. 84%. So white women, we white women educators need to do that work. We need to acknowledge it. We need to realize that our culture, it doesn't feel always like we have culture because it's so prevalent. And then be able to stop and listen. If you're not familiar with the book Street Data, I highly recommend it. There's a technique in Street Data for schools to listen to their families, to listen to their students. One of my favorite methods in there is to ask three questions. Tell us about a time that you felt included in our school. Tell us about a time you felt excluded in our school. And then if you had a magic wand and you could make things more inclusive, more successful for our students, what would you do? And we've used that method. I used it as a superintendent. We held a Michigan Department of Education literacy conference in March, and we had a panel of students who we asked them to speak directly to to that, those questions, but related to literature and the literature that they're asked to read in school. When did they feel included in that? When did they feel excluded? And out of the mouths of babes, they had, I think they sold the show that day. So strategies, do your own personal work, listen. Think about the vocabulary that you use. There's a lot of very deficit-based vocabulary. So examining that, making sure that you're finding the assets. Our students, our families have tremendous strengths. I usually, when I say that I was a superintendent of Muskegon Heights, I ask people, how many people are aware of Muskegon Heights? And I'd ask you not to Google it and have that set your understanding of the community. But instead, I would tell you that it's a community of pride and strength, a community with multiple churches, multi-generational families, tradition who look out for each other. That's what should appear when we Google. That's what would appear if you get to know the families in the community. And then I think the last piece is something, I remember a meeting that we were in together, Dr. Rema, with some families and some leaders, and there was a comment made, and it was completely inappropriate. And it was condescending, it was derogatory towards our families, and I stepped in, and what I felt like I was doing was interrupting. It was against all my middle-class white norms of being polite. And I stopped the conversation and said, that you can't say that. You cannot say that about our families. And later on, we were processing that, and Dr. Rema told me, you weren't interrupting, you were disrupting. That is exactly what you're supposed to do. So staying focused on the job as a disruptor.
Absolutely. Feel free.
I was thinking about this when we all kind of went to self. This wellness piece, I think, is really important. We've been thinking about trauma, and you know, we all know our ACEs scores. We know the ACEs scores of our students. But really, I think that schools are sites of trauma, honestly. I'm not as concerned about what students bring to the classroom. I'm more concerned about what happens to them in the classroom, right? They spend most of their time in these spaces. And if you have not done your own wellness work, you are going to be a traumatizer. All of this work, to me, ends up being trauma if you don't do it, right? So if a student is coming to class and not seeing them in the literature, that's a trauma. If a student is coming to class and they're trying to explain to you their position and you see that as disrespect, that's a trauma. If a parent comes and is disrespected when they come, or they don't show up and you figure out that they just don't care, right? That's a trauma. All of these things are traumas that happen at the school site that I don't think we attend to enough. So how do you then eradicate or address trauma at school? It would mean the educators have to be well. And we talk about students a lot. We don't talk about educators being well and your own wellness and self-care techniques. One of the projects, you asked what we do in this work, one of the projects that Skillman has funded for me is a wellness project where 10 black women principals from Detroit, charter and public, come together and focus on wellness. This is literally radical resistance, because our bodies, particularly black bodies, were brought to this country for our labor. We weren't brought to think. We weren't brought to rest. We weren't brought to have leisure that or pleasure. That was not what we were brought here. And over, we've been tasked and asked to do that again. Just come here for your labor. And educators fall into this trap. We really think that we're doing the best thing by working hard, being the first person there, the last one to leave, taking these buildings as our ownership. One principal said that she left her house on a Sunday when her building was on fire to watch it burn. I thought, oh, wow. Was there something in there that you needed, or were you coming with the hose? I'm not sure why you would leave your house on a Sunday to watch your building burn, particularly because it's not your building. Belongs to the district. And she was like, well, I just feel like I was obligated. I thought, obligated to watch something burn. That was the first day of our work together. I thought, I got a lot of work to do, right? This idea that you are, see, I forget this is being recorded. So let me just go light. I'm not going to go hard in the paint. The fact that you think that you are an owner of something that literally does not belong to you, that you would leave the rest of your home, the rest that you were experiencing in your home on your day off to go to a school, means that you have been conditioned in ways that are harmful to your health. So this, literally, we just take retreats, we read books about rest and wellness, we journal about rest and wellness, we set goals for rest and wellness, and we do fitness classes together, we're going to LA in a couple of weeks to go to a spa. Like, literally, we just focus on wellness. And it's a radical resistance to the pressures of, I gotta keep my words together, of a society that is hell-bent on your production as your worth.
Powerful, thank you. In many of those responses, we heard the archaeology or the excavation of self, the exploration, talked a lot about self. I would like to ask the panelists, because we know the impact of implicit bias. We know how critical it is to do the work of mitigating implicit bias. So why is it important for educators to do that work of mitigating bias? And also, not talking so much about self, but when we recognize that there are educators who need to do that work, how, as fellow educators, do we maybe offer support, provide some direction and guidance, or kind of push folks into that work when we recognize that there is some that needs to be done?
I made that rule, now I want to change it. So, because all the words that I want to say are pretty. And thank you, signers, for this. You all are doing a really good job. I just want to make sure I acknowledge you for your sign. Thank you so much. So let me just say a couple of things about implicit bias. One, DEI work has been so watered down and performative that I really wish DEI would just DIE. I just want it to go away. We can start with some new initiative, because it literally is milquetoast, is a lot of flowery words on a paper that we don't ever go to, right? You just shelve that anti-racist statement and no one ever goes back to it. I'm more interested, yes, we need to do the personal work. I'm not interested in calling people out on their bias. We all are awful, let's just be clear. All of us have biases, we're all terrible. We stink, we're musty, we have a smell of oppression on us. We are all part of that. So I'm not interested in calling other people out. I'm interested in calling myself out only in the policies. The policy is where the potency is. So I'm not trying to figure out, how do you feel about this? I don't care any longer about how you feel. I really just want to see what you're doing. And Gloria Ladson-Billings, who wrote Dream Keepers a long time ago, and literally discovered and then theorized culturally responsive and culturally relevant pedagogy, she told me when I was a grad student at UCLA, she said, white people love paper, Rema. If it's written down, white people will go back to it. I said, okay. So I remembered this. And policy is paper, and white people will adhere to it. So if you are thinking about your work, I say push past, you know, the flowery language, the test. Yes, figure out all the work that you have to do on your own, calling people out. Okay, you would call everybody out here because you all are musty, all of you, right? All of us. Oh, you can go around calling people out, that's fine. The real work is in the policy. What work are you going to do to make sure that when black girls go to school, they're not policed on their bodies, That the first thing when they come in the building is not a scan of their skin. They're not hypersexualized in that way. What policy are you going to produce that says that you can't be excluded from school? Exclusion is the worst thing ever. Exclusion, we do know, leads to then police contact, leads to detention, youth detention, which always leads to prisons. And if you're excluding people, by the way, you're not teaching them to read. 86% of all those who are in prison can't read. These are all connected. What policy are you going to draw up that would say that you can't be excluded, that you have to continue to figure out ways that you are helping a student who is encountering problems instead of thinking of a child as the problem? What policy are you writing for that? The only person who should be excluded from schools are people who are eating people. So Jeffrey Dahmer probably should be excluded. But everybody else can come because you're having a problem that we can solve. You're not the problem. What policy are you going to put in place that says that at the college level, we have to have X number of students from all the different counties, the rural counties, the ones in northern Michigan, the indigenous folks? What policy am I doing? What policy work am I doing in every role in education that I have? I'm not interested anymore in just figuring out where we're biased. It's everywhere. Anti-Black racism is everywhere. It's the root of all evil. So if I want to really do the hard work of changing systems, it's policy. Go beyond yourself as you learn about how terrible you are and repent. And feel awful about that. The only way you repent really is to do policy work. How are you writing in housing regulations that are equitable? How are you addressing food deserts with your policy? How are you making loans to people based on parameters and characteristics that are not normalized? Because we know what normalized means, right? That's not normal for us. You have to think of the policy. Do the implicit bias work, go ahead, do you. Do the DIE work, go ahead, do you, and then change the policy.
To go along with what Dr. Rema is saying, I agree. When she talked about courage, when she talked about policy, a lot of districts, when I was on the task force with Alfredo, when we wrote the framework for the equity plans, a lot of districts in our state won't even write an equity plan, won't even talk about this work. And so what she's saying is, all right, we're talking about implicit bias, trainings, talking about equity. Districts won't even step into this room. It's not a lot of educators here. How many of you are educators? Okay, we got some here, praise God here. But we won't even have mandatory trainings. You talked about the hurt and harm that's happening in districts. We have educators across Michigan. There is mandatory if you are less than 5 years that you have a mentor. It's not mandatory that you are trained in implicit bias training, that you go through Justice Leaders, that you go through the training that you used to do at Eastern. Is not that you go to your mandatory, that you go to your workshops. We ought to have mandatory training so that students are not harmed. We have do not harm trainings, but there's not mandatory. If you come to Ipsy, you got mandatory training with Yolanda, you got mandatory training with Goldie, you got mandatory training with Muhammad Khalifa, you got mandatory. I can go down the list. And it's embedded. And not every district is embedded. It's not every district where you're going to have training. And there's other districts where there's going to be harm. Now, I can't say that there's not going to be harm in Ypsilanti Community Schools, but I'm going to tell you there's going to be mandatory training. And so when you ask that question, there's the issue. It's not mandatory. There is harm that's going to be happening, yet there's not going to be in every classroom across this great state restorative circles that's going to happen. There's not training that's happening that in every classroom. It should happen. This should be required in our state. There ought to be training in our higher education institutions before you ought to get a license to teach. And so part of where we break this cycle, before you get in front of students, you ought to be trained, because we understand that this harm is going to happen if we don't train our teachers. And we know, like Dr. Rema said, we know our ACEs scores. We understand that this cycle can be broken. And it's the fact that we ought to talk to our legislators. They mandate every other thing. They mandate what we ought to teach, what we spend seat time hours on, what the curriculum needs to be, what kind of testing we need. We test them every second for everything else. But when we start talking about all these things, especially with the least of these, with the students who need the most, then we can't break this other piece of the cycle. And so that's part of what we ought to all be fighting for, is the type of training that the teachers who are in front of the students who need the most need to have.
Thank you.
Whew. All right. There's so much here, right? And it's on so many different levels. When I think about the implicit bias, and I think about focused on that and opportunity and access, that's where we're focused at MDE. And Elena, your point is well taken, right? The Michigan Department of Education does not make the rules. We enforce them. The legislators do. So appealing to legislators to mandate requirements, that's important. One, local control as well. It's happening in Ypsilanti. It can happen in different places with the right advocacy, with the right conversations. But also thinking about Dr. Rema's point that we're all biased. And I know you asked Melissa for us not to look at self, but we have to, right? We have to look at self. And that's going to be as important, if not more important, than calling somebody else out. When we look at self, when we look at our local districts, when we look at our state level data, finding out where the opportunity and the access doesn't exist, crunch the numbers. It's everywhere, right? It's pervasive. Pick the spot to start. Ethnicity, clearly, we could start there. Disability status, gender identity. We have too many children that are not being supported. We can start in any of those places, we can start in all of those places, but I think the key is to start the conversations and to push them hard.
Thank you. Any follow-up?
I like this. So, we talked about courage. It does take the courage to first look at yourself, but then look at the data, right? Again, what's respected? And I don't think you necessarily have to go out of your sphere of influence. To Renee's point, you can go around the corner and find implicit bias, and you can go around the corner and see where there's oppression, right? You could see where there's suppression anywhere. So you don't have to go far. In your own sphere of influence, figure out those pressure points. The pain points where people are suffering, where people are being treated unjustly. You can figure that out, and then you have to leverage your skills, your talents, your network, right? Your knowledge your expertise, your degrees, you have to leverage it for the change wherever you are. I think there were maybe 5 educators in here. So you're from all different spheres, all different walks of life. We should be seeing, okay, in that housing market, we see her busting moves. Oh, over here, he's already created a whole urban garden, right? Like, I should be able to see your work because you looked at the data and then made a decision to change something. First through policy, I would say. Again, you gotta go through policy. These people love policy. But then also your work should reflect whatever your passion is or whatever your grimiest part of yourself is, really. I think you should work on that for the greater good. But the data is really important. People, just do your homework so that you can make an argument.
Thank you so much. So many of your comments resonate so very clearly, particularly with work that I have done and also in relationship to MDE around Indigenous education. And I think about that data piece and that I believe over 80% of textbooks do not have any reference or representation of Native Indigenous people after 1900. So when a textbook does reference or indicate and include Native people, it's pre-1900. And then I think about the work, again, so honored to do with MDE and the Confederation of Michigan Tribal Ed Directors was to create Mondonganin, which was to align with the social studies standards, which is a way, it's not policy, but it's supporting policy, to provide those resources for teachers and for educators and for administrators to have resources and materials and content to support their work in social studies education. So I love hearing these things. It makes me, really reflect, which is, I think, what we're probably all doing as we listen to these amazing, amazing panelists. And very early in our conversation, we talked about representation, and some of you provided some specific examples or personal stories around representation. And as we think about accurate and appropriate representation, historically accurate, culturally appropriate representation, what are some ways in which we can expand upon and grow representation? And that may be in and through curriculum and materials and approaches, but it may also be how do we increase representation in our districts, educators? Are our educators representing our communities? We just made, I think someone just referenced, 84% of our educators are white women. So how do we increase representation in these different areas? If you want to maybe pick one, or you have an example, or you have an experience, I'd love to hear that.
This is a question I've been waiting for. At the Michigan Department of Education, we've been using the terms mirrors and windows to represent this work. So we have 3 major efforts to increase representation that I want to make sure that I share with you. The first one is diversity in literature, and I brought along, it's written down on paper, diversifying the classroom libraries. So the work behind this, it speaks to Goldie Muhammad and her work, Dr. Rudine Sims Bishop and her work. So the idea, the concept is that every classroom should have books that represent the children in it and their multiple identities. Not only their families and their heritage, but also their current self and their future self, where they would like to go. That's not an easy thing to do, because about half of the books, children's books published, represent white children. So that doesn't leave a lot of books or a lot of other, and I think it's another 26% that are animal characters, right? So that doesn't leave a lot for other identities to be represented, but it is possible, and we're working to work with districts to lead the way. So if you're interested in that work, that's mirrors. The other idea behind that is windows. We know that our schools, our communities are very segregated. So our children are growing up in environments where they don't have the opportunity to learn a lot about each other, to learn diversely. When our books could represent self, mirrors, and others windows that gives children a chance to start their learning early. So that's one effort that I think is very important. I want to lift that. We're working really hard to lift that throughout the state. Another one is teaching comprehensive history. So I'm glad you brought that up. The Michigan Department of Education Board of Education passed a resolution about the importance of teaching comprehensive history. The Michigan State Social Studies standards that were passed in 2019 are full of standards that support teaching comprehensive history, diverse perspectives, exploring diverse perspectives, and helping students become critical thinkers. So in an effort to raise teacher understanding, we launched a teaching comprehensive history effort in April of last year. We started focused on remembering the Holocaust. We then went to a presentation on Mundungunan with the Confederation of Michigan Tribal Education Departments, and they presented their work. Not me, not other members of our department, but they presented their own work, and that work is full of resources that are indigenously vetted to be the proper resources to teach all children. We moved from there into a webinar on with the Asian American Studies out of the Michigan State University on immigration and citizenship. In January of this year, we launched into the 13th, 14th, and 15th amendments to the U.S. Constitution and why those would be necessary after the Civil War ended and emancipation. Why did we still need those? These are all available on our website. That was done with a law professor out of the University of Michigan. Our next series was a civil rights movement. We did an equal rights movement. We did a disability rights movement. And our last one was a labor rights movement. Again, the Michigan Department of Education, teaching comprehensive history. If you Google that, you will find those recordings and the resources. And they allow for the accurate, multiple perspective of history instruction. The third and final one that I want to mention is the diversifying the teacher workforce. We are working on a number of efforts to improve the pipeline of teachers, and starting back at middle school, high school, and working with people who work in schools but aren't teachers. They don't have their certification. So they might be instructional assistants. They might be secretaries. They have a bachelor's degree. They can get an alternate route to certification. What we know about those populations of future educators is they are more diverse than our current population. So by supporting them financially, structurally, it will help diversify the entire teacher workforce. So three efforts.
Gwetch, thank you.
In Ypsilanti Community Schools, we also are working through the diverse classroom libraries. We have a literacy grant, $500,000 over the 5 years. We put $100,000 already into diversifying our classroom libraries. So we have we give out quarterly to build the libraries of our students' homes. So not just in our own libraries in the classrooms of our teachers, but our students go through Scholastic. They have the diverse libraries that go home so that they can build their libraries at home, because we know that many of our students don't have libraries at home. So they go through the Scholastic and are able to choose their own books, and they take them home and they get excited about making their own selection and being able to take them and read them at home with their families. We also are able to have media specialists that look like them, so the circulation has increased, and so those persons are able to choose books that, again, look like the students and are able to engage in conversations that are just robust with the students, and they bring them down and have good conversations and are able to build relationships, because, again, relationships matter. So the literacy the literacy and conversations in those libraries. Secondly, our Grow Your Own program really just has been highlighted in Washtenaw County. We have a pair pro to teacher program that has going on with Eastern Michigan University prior to the pandemic. The one, and Ypsilanti, we have a 96% rate of our staff have stayed the entire program. So we have a CI program and an EI program, a pair pro to teacher program, and ours are minority men and women, the intersectionality, and they are pair pros from the neighborhood. They know the students. They have great relationships, and so we have the pipeline who will be special education teachers in our building. We also have a teacher student leader U.S. Department of Education grant of a teacher to principal program and a principal to central office program, $5.1 million a year. And they will become the leaders in our district. And so we call them friends and then principals. So they will become either a rising leader in our district to, they can do the Galileo approach from leading to from where we stand, or they can become a principal in our district. And those persons, we do truly target our minority population and our men, especially our minority men and our women leaders. And so as we have openings, we want to fill from within. And so again, our students can see our look at the mirrors and windows and really see that they can be leaders in the district. We also have in our district, we hire our parents to trusted parent advisors so that they can not just be informants to help us, to let us understand how can they help. So we just had our FACE conference and family, I can't even think of the name, but they gave the name to it. But they teach us how to engage, what they wanted the conference to be about. How do we engage our parents? What topics they wanted to have in the conference? And again, is how do we engage? What they want? What do they want to explore and what's important to them? So they had the conference once. They tell us how to have the boots on the ground. What days do we go out into the community? What resources might be important to them? And so again, this is how we get the voices and how we find out what's important to our community.
Thank you.
Let me think about this. So representation matters. That's what you said. Okay, representation matters. I do want to say that if you tell the truth, more minoritized people would want to come to into education. You were talking about the indigenous folks and having their history cut short, right, in the history books. But I even wonder what history they were telling and if that was accurate, right? I just don't think that we tell the truth about what really has happened to people in this country. And I think minoritized people would feel respected and want to come into this profession if they felt like you were telling the truth about them. I'm a rebel, so I think I was not diagnosed. I missed the diagnosis on oppositional defiance disorder because I literally did not. I was just hard-headed. So I'm a rebel. I'll go into a place to change it, but most of us won't do that. I'll go into a place that doesn't have anyone who looks like me and not feel a way about that. Most of us won't do that. And so I think we need to make sure that people are telling the truth about folks in their legacy and the beauty of their heritage in our literature in all facets of school so that you know, people will go into it. The other thing I would say is you need to pay teachers. So when I started, when I started teaching, when I moved to California, I literally, I promise you, qualified for food stamps. The pride in me would not let me take them, but my income was so low that I could have gotten food stamps. That was, how do you come out with a whole degree and you on your knuckles? That doesn't make any sense. So a lot of my peers who were my classmates didn't go into education, because that's not how you get paid. And if you have generations who were not able to make money, who are not having generational wealth come from with them to when they go to college and when they get lifted, who are not gonna get a small $1 million loan to start their business, right? Like, if you don't have these kinds of folks in going into education, you have to figure out how you pay people who are minoritized to be in the space. If we think about Black women, they're in the United States, Black women are the highest degreed women, citizens in the United States. We have more degrees than anyone else. We have more education than anyone else. We also have the highest debt to income ratio. We're also the last to be promoted into the C-suite, the most disrespected, right, in terms of pay. Part of the pay is the issue, right? Because women, there's a disparity between men and women, but there's also a disparity between Black women and all men, right? And so we're the lowest paid. But also our debt when we come out of college. If you want a pipeline of educators, pay for their school. You come in, you come in, you qualify for food stamps, and you got a loan? Come on, man. Y'all doing too much and not enough at the same time. You need to pay for people to go to school. So one of the things that is happening at Wayne State is we have a LIFT program. We've partnered with, who are they we partnered with? I know Carnegie is doing the coaching for folks, but you can, if you are committed to working in high need areas, and you are in education right now, you can go and get your master's. There's gonna be a $20,000 stipend that you could use to your tuition. You also get free coaching. Well, it's never the free. I don't think anything's free, but you get coaching throughout your program and then for 5 years after your program in a cohort. So I want people to come into education who are well-intentioned, who want to do the best thing for students, and who also don't need debt. I don't want you to have to pay. So I'm doing my part at Wayne State, my little part. It's not big enough, but pay people a living wage. And that's respectful. And educators need to stop talking about themselves as missionaries. This is not missionary work. Missionaries don't get paid. You're a professional. I'm doing the Lord's work. Amen. Now get paid. Get your money. Do the Lord's work and also be valued with a paycheck. The last thing I would say is you have to rethink schools. Nobody wants to come into raggedy schools. Nobody does. Like, you have to rethink the way we do education. What we've been doing does not work. Go to the data. We are losing in every category. If you think about Michigan, when I was here as a student a long time ago, many, many moons ago, we were on top. We've gone down. Sometimes we beat a state that I won't name. We beat a state that doesn't get beaten in education in our outcomes. We, Michigan, we used to be the premier. It's because we've been stagnant. We haven't changed. We're still on an industrial model, still preparing people for factory jobs that are not there. Why are your kids in uniforms? Why are your kids walking in straight lines? Why are your kids literally being docked for grades based on their attendance when their attendance is about tardiness? Come on, man. They're not going to any of these jobs. They don't exist any longer. You don't go to a job where you clock in and clock out where you have a uniform. None of you do. Your attendance is not mandatory. You can do your work from home, most of you. Why are we still preparing people this way? Control, compliance, coercion, acculturation. These are the highest ideals of education, not creativity, not problem solving, not higher thinking, not collaboration. That's not what we're doing in our schools. I just left Egypt. Egypt wanted to talk about ways that they can better their schools. I'm like, don't look over here. Because when I went to their schools, what I saw, I went to a STEM school, a public school. Everyone was in triads or dyads. No one worked alone. It was project-based, place-based work. The work that we're doing in my STEM for, or trying to get done across the state in my STEM, they were doing work that was inquiry-based. So there were, I'll give you an example, 11th grade student dyad, two girls working on a cure. So the one girl had broken her leg and doing Taekwondo and figured out that she had a hereditary disease that eroded her bone marrow. So she decided that she would figure out a cure for this that afflicted her grandmother, her mother, right, all the way up. She extracted bone marrow from cows, added an enzyme to it to strengthen bone marrow, sold it to the pharmaceutical company, and got it patented. 11th grade. Another one was working on hydration systems. Another one was thinking about how to make straws out of rice. Right? They're looking at their environment. They're pursuing the problems of their world, and then leveraging their resources in that school to solve real world problems. Why can't we do that? They didn't go to an English class, a science class, a math class. All of their work was embedded in place-based work. It was all applied knowledge. And if the guide, not the teacher, the guide didn't know what to do, the guide wasn't upset about that, like, oh, you're asking questions that I don't know, let me be defensive and maybe kick you out the class. No, instead they went to where they could find the answer, the expert who was in hydration, the expert who was in refining soil, right? Like, they went to go find other people to bring into the classroom. When I talk to this kid off to the side, because, you know, you get them by themselves, the students will tell you the truth. They always tell you the truth. So I'm like, so tell me what the discipline issue is here. She was like, I'm not sure what you're talking about. Like, what, when you get in trouble, what happens? What kind of trouble? What happens when you do the wrong thing? Like, not go to calisthenics on time and miss the morning mantra? I said, what did you do? Morning calisthenics. And we do a mantra together to set our day. If you're late for that, you might get a strong talking to. They didn't have any discipline issues because they were engaged. They're doing real work that changes their own communities. We have to rethink schools. We don't have to be married to these old antiquated systems that don't serve us. We're gonna continue the race to the bottom if we don't rethink what we do in schools, how we do it, who we're teaching, and how we're teaching them.
Thank you. Those were our questions and our beautiful and eloquent responses from our panelists, but we also know that you may have some questions as well. So we want to take about 10 minutes for some Q&A, and we we'll have a fellow staff member, Tiara, who has the mic. So if you have questions, what we do ask is that you raise your hand. Please provide a question. If you have a specific panelist that you would like to ask the question of, feel free. But again, phrase your comment in the form of a question. Please provide your name before speaking. Please note that you will not be on camera. The cameras will remain on the panelists. And again, Tiara will be moving around the room with the microphone. So if anyone has a question. And again, we'll take about 10 minutes for Q&A.
Hi, my name is Kristen Mrozek. Too close to my face. I am a teacher over here at Novi High School, and I'm also on the district and building DEI committee. I just had a quick question, because while I think some districts are pushing further in this work, I think some districts are just kind of still like, ooh, let's do this now, which is far behind. But one of the things that was brought up a few times was policy. And we're kind of at that stage where we're like, okay, where do we go exactly? And so I'm curious which policy we should start with, because we have our board policy, we have like our staff handbooks, we have our MyKit plan. Are you suggesting maybe a multi-prong approach, or is there one spot where you're like, start here, this is really great?
My work with schools in Detroit, another school in Okemos, was around their dress code. And this prompt was prompted from where Keisha's from. You're from Jackson, correct? So in Keisha's region, there was a little girl who went to school for picture day and was not able to take her picture because her mother had put these braids in her hair, nice little updo, goddess, that's what it's called, goddess braids up to a crown. And it had a little bit of red in it. And in their dress code, you can't have any colors in your hair. So she was pulled out of line, had to go to the library while everyone else took their picture, right? And so she was upset about this. Her mother had spent this time last night, and she thought she looked cute, and here she was not able to take her picture, and she was in second grade. So that work prompted, that incident prompted other schools to look at their dress code. If you look at your dress code, you'll find everything that ails you. If you look at your dress code, you'll find sexism, you'll find racism, you'll find ableism, you'll find homophobia, and sometimes you'll find Islamophobia. So I would start with something as benign, right, as dress code. Like, oh, let's just start in this look right here. And then look at all the isms, because classism is in there too. Look at all the isms within your dress code and just look at it for that. And then think about ways that you would change it to be more equitable and free for students. Like, for example, if a girl comes in and she's showing her shoulder, I guess shoulders are sexy. I don't know, but I don't think they are, but whatever. So she has to somehow cover that up because they're sexy. Sexy to whom? And if that person cannot control themselves, is that really the sexy shoulder problem or the person who can't control themselves? And what message are you sending to her about how she's supposed to contort herself in order for someone not to hypersexualize or objectify her? And then what message are you sending to the people who are objectifying her? That it's her responsibility to keep them from being maniacs? Like, these are all messages we send in our dress code. So I would start there, because that's the tool, one of the tools that you can use for all things terrible. And then you can start from all other policies. But that even the dress code causes everything else, like suspensions, expulsions, detentions, and all these other things. That you even have detention in your school means that schools are not a school-to-prison pipeline, that you literally are the prison, because that literally is a carceral term. But start there later, because you got to start small. Yeah, go through that. And go through it with students.
That was what I was going to add. Ask your students. Ask them. Do they feel a sense of belonging? If they don't, why not? Do they have access? If they don't, why not? And address those. Look for the low-hanging fruit. Show people it's not really painful to allow all children to have access and opportunity. It's good for all of us. We'll have more joy, more wealth, more beauty in our world when all have access. So I'd suggest starting there, and also what can change in the classroom for children. Stay focused on the children.
I would also say get someone to help you, because an outsider's lens is really important. Because if you ask students, you know, what is belonging, they won't tell you. Or how are you being harmed, they won't. I mean, most of us don't know how we're being harmed. How, you know, so you really do have to have someone else to help you kind of examine and excavate.
We have another question.
Thank you. I'm Dr. Monique James. And my question, well, first I have a comment. Thank you so much for pointing out the importance of reflection, transparency, and accountability. And my question centers around educational excellence and the challenges that we experience in K through 12 are often reflected in higher education also. And Governor Whitmer recently allocated monies to address learning losses during the time of COVID, and around $300 million, I believe. And my question is, how do we increase community involvement around education, the common unity around education, and make sure that people are aware, that communities are aware and can advocate for equitable distribution of those resources to the communities that were disproportionately impacted by COVID-19 and learning loss?
We are very fortunate that there were funds expended for lots of funds expended. I know for us, we spent a lot of our funds on high dosage tutoring and partners. We currently have Grizzly Learning Camp going on, and we've partnered with our neighbors, Eastern Michigan University, Washtenaw Community College, and others, so that we have over a third of our population currently in Grizzly Learning Camp, including which this year that there's a difference that we have even our secondary students involved. And so we got our community involved by sending out messages, asking our partners with Ann Arbor Natural Museum of History, really going out with the Boots on the Ground campaign, just asking those outsiders to come in to try to give enrichment and exposure. I think we do need to do better trying to go outside to say, in other communities, our community is pretty small, but how do we get out into the broader community? How do we engage others in coming into the other K-12 environments to get involved in the schools? Because I don't think that's happening other places.
Yeah, I would just add on to that to go to your local school and ask them the question. How are you using this money for, and how can we engage? Mentorship is critically important. If you have people willing to come in and partner with students, one student, right? Once a week, 1 hour, spend some time, follow that student for multiple years. We know that that's a huge place to make an impact. And schools are busy, overwhelmed places very often. So knock on the door. It's the courage. Knock on the door and say, I'm here, I want to help.
You talked about transparency and accountability. And I think what I have learned in my 30 years in education, particularly in K-12 spaces, because higher ed is a whole different animal, but K-12 spaces, parents can be your biggest advocates, but they also can be the biggest sources of lessons, right? Because they do bring, if they are informed, parents will bring accountability. Every time I had a problem with a parent, it was a problem with me, actually, and my lack of transparency or accountability. So my work in Pasadena, particularly in Altadena, but it started in Altadena, but it got scaled up to Pasadena Unified, was around engaging parents, right? So there's an African-American parent council that's still there today that started in 2011, that started Altadena Elementary and now is a Pasadena initiative. We had to organize parents for accountability and transparency. And that meant that we had to go out to them, right? Go to the Y games, go to the grocery stores. A lot of teachers don't live in the neighborhoods that they teach in. And so on your way home, stop at the grocery store, go to the Boys and Girls Club on the weekends, right? You have to kind of figure out where parents are so that they can be partners with you. To me, they're the secret weapon. If we really want reform, if we really want a different school system, if we really want to bring about justice, parents are the key.
There's a study that says when we do that with parents, that they then become more involved in the schools. They'll often run for the school board and then run for local office. And that's where that cycle gets complete back to the policy, right? When the parents become informed and engaged, they will make the change. And that's the way it should be. Community schools.
I believe that we are out of time. Unfortunately, I know that there may have been a few more questions. I don't know if the panel is willing to sit just for a few more minutes if people want to come up and maybe ask a question. I'll provide just a couple of housekeeping matters, and then depending on the panelists' willingness to have some more conversation. Thank you, Tiara, for your assistance with the microphone. Again, just a very big thank you, Chimagwech, and gratitude offered up to our panelists for the wonderful conversation. We do have a 15-minute break scheduled, so lunch will not begin until noon, so we do have a little bit of a buffer until noon of that 15-minute break. Just a quick note regarding lunch. Lunch will be found out in the lobby. It will be set up with box lunches at tables. They will be labeled with different choice options for your lunch. And if you have specific dietary restrictions that you identified upon registration due to any allergies, there will be a designated space, a designated table for very specific meal choices based on those restrictions and requests with names on the boxes. And we have staff out there who will be able to help. And then we do have a lunch. We will be having lunch, so take your box lunch into the large ballroom where we will also have a lunch plenary. So if we could, before we break, even though and if our panelists are willing to have some additional conversation, if people would like, let's please offer them a round of applause for their time, for their expertise, and their powerful words. So thank you so much. And again, I know that there were a few questions that people maybe wanted to get in, and that's really up to you all if you're willing to have folks share some conversation. You have to go.